heart? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of a dry ground. He hath no form nor comeliness. And when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is dumb, so he openeth not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment, and who shall declare his generation? For he was cut off out of the land of the living. For the transgression of my people was he stricken. And he made his grave with the wicked, and with the rich in his death, because he had done no violence, neither was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed. He shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see of the travail of his soul, and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore will I divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he hath poured out his soul unto death. And he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bare the sin of many, and made intercession for the transgressors.
Yes.
Olives, Jesus reminded his disciples, saying, "As you know, the Passover is coming, and the time for the Son of Man to be betrayed and handed over for crucifixion draws near." The Passover festival was to be celebrated in 2 days, and gathered in the courtyard of the high priest Caiaphas were the religious leaders who conspired together on how best to silence Jesus. They were concerned about how the people listened to him and how he grew in influence and popularity. As the discussion progressed, they said, "His death must not occur during the Passover festival. Otherwise, people might riot against us." Jesus had been invited to the home of Simon the leper, whose home was in the town of Bethany. While there, a woman arrived carrying an alabaster vial of very costly and precious perfume of pure nard. It is often used in burial rituals. She opened the vial and poured the perfume over Jesus. Jesus heard the critical remarks being made by some present as they said, "What a waste of something so valuable! This perfume could have been sold to benefit the poor." Jesus turned to them and said, "Why are you causing trouble? She has done a good and beautiful thing for me. There will always be the poor, and you can serve them whenever you wish. I, however, will not always be here. She has done her best to serve me and has anointed my body for my burial." Judas Iscariot, who was one of the 12 disciples, left and sought out the religious leaders. He offered a solution to their problem, saying, "If I deliver Jesus into your custody, what reward will you offer?" They settled on a price and paid Judas 30 pieces of silver. From that moment, Judas lay in wait to see it done.
To be a friend who chose to live.
Jesus and his disciples celebrated the first day of the Passover festival together by sharing a traditional meal. Jesus shared that one among them would betray him. Upon hearing this, Peter passionately argued, "No matter whom I deny you, I will never deny you." With sadness in his eyes, Jesus looked at him and said, "Before this night is ended, you will hear the rooster crow. You will have denied me 3 times. After the meal, Jesus came out and went, as was his habit, to the Mount of Olives. When he arrived at the place called Gethsemane, he said to those disciples that joined him, "Pray continually that you may not fail in the moment of temptation." He then slowly walked away, seeking a secluded place to pray. Jesus fell on his knees and in anguish prayed, saying, "Father, I know what is to come, that I was sent to drink the cup of your wrath. I willingly submit, knowing that it means a complete separation from you. Father, your will be done." Seeking out his disciples, he found them sleeping. "Why are you sleeping?" he asked. "Get up and pray that you do not give in to the temptations to come." Going back into seclusion, he continued to pray, saying, "My Father, if this cup cannot pass away unless I drink it, your will be done." An angel appeared to him from heaven and ministered to Jesus in his grief. Jesus, being deeply distressed, he prayed even more intently so that his sweat became like drops of blood falling to the ground. Jesus, returning to his disciples, found them asleep again. And again, Jesus warned them to pray. He went back to pray for a third time.
Call of redemption, Father.
returned to the disciples, he woke them up, saying, "Are you still sleeping? The moment is here. Look, my betrayer is coming." As Jesus was still speaking, Judas was entering the garden with a crowd of men who had swords and clubs. Judas spoke to those in the crowd, "Whomever I kiss, he is the one. Seize him and lead him away safely." Judas made his way to embrace Jesus. "Rabbi," Jesus said, and kissed him. In that moment, the crowd surged forward, seizing Jesus to arrest him. Jesus questioned them, saying, "Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me as you would a violent criminal, when you could have done this any of the many days I was with you, teaching in the courts and porches of the temple?" May scriptures be fulfilled. After the arrest, his disciples were in fear for their lives and fled. The crowd followed as Jesus was led away by the soldiers to where the religious leaders were lying in wait for him. Peter had followed behind Jesus at a distance, careful to not draw attention to himself. He walked into the courtyard of the high priest, trying to blend in with the guards and servants that were warming themselves at the fire. While by the fire, one of the servant girls recognized Peter. "You were with Jesus the Nazarene," she declared. Peter panicked. "I don't know what you're talking about." He tried to escape and went on to the porch, but the servant girl pursued him, claiming, "This man is one of them." Peter again denied it, but they continued to accuse him. "You are his follower," they said. Peter, feeling angry, began to swear, "I do not know him." At that very moment, a rooster could be heard crowing. Peter instantly remembered what Jesus said to him. Peter fled, weeping in despair and regret.
Despised and rejected, betrayed and
They made many accusations against Jesus, saying, "This man is purposefully misleading and perverting our nation and forbidding us to pay taxes to Caesar, and claiming that he is Christ, the Messiah, the anointed, a king." Pilate turned his attention to Jesus and asked, "Are you, as they claim, king of the Jews?" Jesus quietly answered him, "It is just as you say." Pilate, confused, said, "Do you not hear the serious accusation they make against you?" But Jesus stood quietly, not giving any response, and Pilate was greatly astonished. He declared to all those present, "I find no guilt in this man." However, those who accused Jesus said, "He stirs up the people to rebel the teaching throughout Judea, starting in Galilee, throughout the land, even to here in Jerusalem." Pilate was not fooled. He knew, but out of jealousy and fear, that the religious leaders wanted Pilate to be the one who passed judgment. Frustrated, Pilate asked of them, "Then what shall I do with Jesus who is called Christ?" They replied, "Let him be crucified." Pilate said, "But why? What has he done to deserve such a brutal death?" But the shouts from the crowd grew as they chanted, "Crucify him! Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate clearly understood that the crowd would not only riot if he did not do as they wished. He then chose to wash his hands in a ceremony to publicly absolve himself of any guilt in this matter, saying, "I am innocent of this righteous man's blood. The responsibility for this is on you." pronounced, Jesus was handed over to the Roman soldiers to see it done. They took Jesus into the praetorium, where they gathered the whole Roman battalion around him. They publicly stripped him and mocked him by putting a scarlet robe about his shoulders. Twisting together a crown of thorns, they pressed down until it punctured his skin. As blood began to pour down his face, then they put a reed in his right hand as if it were a scepter. Kneeling before him, they taunted Jesus, disdainfully saying, "Hail, King of the Jews!" They spat on Jesus and used the reed from his hand to beat him. The soldiers scourged him with a whip, repeatedly ripping open the skin on his back. After they finished, they stripped Jesus of the scarlet robe and put his own clothes back on his bloody body. Then they placed a heavy cross on his back and began the half-mile walk through the city. At one point, Jesus could no longer bear the burden he carried. So they had to seize a man, Simon of Cyrene, who was in the crowd. They forced him to carry the cross the rest of the way. There were also two other criminals that were being led away to be executed as well that day. A growing crowd of people followed the procession. Some were mocking and jeering, and others were mourning and wailing for Jesus. The procession finally ended outside the city gates at a place called Golgotha. It means the place of the skull.
Down the Via Dolorosa in Jerusalem.
inscription had been nailed on the cross, "This is the King of the Jews." After nailing Jesus to the cross and lifting it up for all to see, the soldiers offered Jesus wine mixed with myrrh. It is a bitter-tasting narcotic, and after tasting it, Jesus refused to drink it. Jesus hung on the cross, and the two criminals who were also to be crucified were placed on either side of Jesus. Jesus, struggling to breathe, said, "Father, forgive them, because they do not understand what they are doing." The crowd watched, some in delight and others in horror, as the high priest sneered at Jesus, saying, "He saved others from death. Let him save himself if he can. If he is Christ the Messiah, the anointed of God, God's chosen one. Did he not claim that he would destroy the temple and rebuild it in only 3 days? Then, save yourself by coming down from that cross." Jesus was cruelly offered sour wine by soldiers. They began to taunt him, "If you really are the King of the Jews, save yourself from death." One of the criminals who was being crucified beside Jesus kept hurling abuse at him, saying, "Are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us from death." But the other criminal scolded him, saying, "So near to death, don't you have any fear of God? We deserve to die this way because of what we have done. But this man is completely innocent." The dying thief then turned to Jesus. "Please, please, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Jesus whispered, "I promise you, this very day, you will enter paradise with me." As the sun rose even higher in the sky, a heavy, ever-deepening darkness began to fall over all the land until the mid-afternoon. In that moment that Jesus drew himself up, he cried out in a loud, mournful voice, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Jesus, crying out one last time, gave up his spirit, sovereignly releasing his spirit from his body in submission to his Father's plan. Immediately, the sound of the veil that separated the people from the Holy of Holies in the temple could be heard as it was ripped from the top all the way to the bottom. A massive earthquake shook throughout the land, and the boulders were split apart. A certain centurion who had kept guard over Jesus and those who were with him, who witnessed all these things, were frightened. Then the centurion cried out in a loud voice, "Truly, this man was the Son of God."